What you gonna do, brother, when Jeff Townsend Media runs wild on you?
All right, all right, all right. Welcome to the Bill DeMott Experience. Bill had a cough when I say that. Welcome to the Bill DeMott Experience. Bill's been coughing for over a month. He's been sick and hacking still, but this is actually recorded on the, what's today's date, Bill? It's 21st. Yeah, we're not going to be recording in the following week, so we're going to go ahead and making some extra content for you here. So, Bill, I'm excited to run over a little bit. I know you're sleepy, but I have some cool stuff in store for you.
Let's do it. I'm excited. Let's go.
All right, so to kick things off, I know Noah's been waiting. I'm going to Noah first since you know him here. He did that treatment. Two questions. What was it like wrestling The Undertaker? We've talked about that before.
Yeah.
Noah must be a new listener. Thanks for joining us, Noah.
Yeah.
And then if CM Punk wins the Royal Rumble, will he face Seth Rollins or Roman Reigns? Two questions for you.
Okay, first question, working with The Undertaker is a... That's one of those things that you kind of hope you get the opportunity to do. And then if you can get past the stage fright and the, oh my gosh, moments and please don't let me, you know, mess this up kind of mentality you have when you're working with one of the biggest stars in the industry, it's awesome, man. And I was fortunate enough to do it on live events for loops at a time and months at a time and the TV spots that we had together. So I put that on my, you know, notch in my belt of one of my favorite people to work with. So, and he's just an awesome guy and he's a leader in the ring. So Undertaker's always awesome and a great experience. As far as CM Punk winning the Royal Rumble, I mean, I'm torn because I think, if you asked me this 6 months ago, ultimately the ultimate prize is a Universal Heavyweight Championship. But now the work that Seth has done and put in and raised that championship up and really been the Iron Man of the two champions, you know, been there consistently and doing his thing. I think you'd have to, I don't want to give it away because I think there's so many people now involved in who can go where and win the Rumble. I think 2 months ago, everybody thought it was just going to be Cody. And then Punk came back and Orton came back. And now we have these things and everybody's gunning for Reigns and gunning for this and gunning for Seth and Drew McIntyre's in there somewhere. And let's not forget, you know, all these other people that want a shot at it. But if I was Punk, I'd go with Seth Rollins.
A lot of people are saying that they might keep it on the big dog for another year so he can pass Hogan's record.
It could be.
Okay, so this is how this is going to go. I have 10 different things to talk about. So just to make this extra fun, I didn't save the file name. So these are just showing up as whatever the Google Drive file, replay, whatever, the screen recording file name. Okay. So I actually don't know what order we're going to go in here. That's the fun part about this. So these are people they sent in. Want to know your thoughts about these people, these situations, etc.
Okay.
We're going to go to the first one here, man. I really don't know what it's going to bring. I'm kind of excited.
Life used to be very simple. Fight or die. It was like breathing. If you stop, you die. But I was lured away into a world of lies, of illusions, a world where life was easy, civilized. But I couldn't live the lie, because I couldn't escape the truth. Life is pain. I'm Wade Barrett, and my barrage has just begun.
thoughts on Wade Barrett was a question, so I figured that would be a cool thing to bring up to segue into it.
I think he one of the most underutilized talent.
Oh. I don't want to say like completely underutilized because he still did a lot of great stuff. Let's not lie.
But
his run should have been that neck. First of all, sorry to cut you off.
No, go ahead.
Over the Nexus storyline. He should have been a champion at some point during that. There were so many other times and opportunities where they could have ran with Wade Barrett and they didn't for whatever reason. Your thoughts on your experience working with Wade? What did you, how much were you around him and all that? That's what the group, right?
Yeah. He was one of those young cats that came up during that time, the Sheamus, McIntyre, all those guys that came up around that time. You knew he had a ton of potential. I thought he had the it factor. Big, tall, good-looking kid who could go, who was a man's man. I think there's a lot of opportunities for him, and I think they just let them fall because they, unfortunately, at that time, if they ran out of things to write for you, you were just put on the back burner. I was happy to see him back now and doing what he's doing now because he's extremely talented and he's learned his craft, but I was a Wade Barrett fan. And I am a Wade Barrett fan, but he was one of those guys I really thought that they could have gone to the next level with. And there's no telling why they didn't, but huge fan. There was a lot of missed opportunities, I think. And like you said, starting with Nexus and I've got some bad news. It was going over huge with the crowds and live events and TVs and everything else. And it just, for whatever reason, it didn't float. He left the company for a little bit, came back. He's doing great behind the desk. And he's got a lot to offer. So I'm a huge fan of his. And I'm glad his career has worked out past the in-ring.
Yeah. I shared that particular one when the person asked about him because I really liked how they played off his real life bare knuckle boxing kind of.
Yeah, bare knuckle.
He is a tough guy, you know?
Yeah.
And I thought that was another cool thing that just didn't, like you said, they just didn't go all the way with it, dude. But yeah, man, we got another one here, a presentation. I don't know what it's going to be, but we'll see. How fun is this, Bill?
I like this.
Entertainment. Anyone who tries to make a distinction between education and entertainment doesn't know the first thing about either. Famed sociologist Marshall McLuhan. Entertainment in our society is at a tragic all-time low, riddled with nonsensical pop culture that has little or no social, moral, or educational qualities. Gone are the days where the masses were captivated by the works of Shakespeare and Mozart, abhorrently replaced with observing the lives of ever-so-desperate housewives, or fist-pumping to eardrum-shattering bass in a sea of false tans and false bravados. Historically, one can judge a civilization as to how they choose to entertain themselves. It is a direct reflection on their moral and ethical code. Sadly, your mirror reflection reveals that you are a people of laziness, mediocrity, and complacency. Blame you for this said ignorance? That is something I pledge to never do. Save you from this said ignorance. Now that is the essence of my true calling. You're welcome.
This is going to be an episode of Wasting Talent. Back to back, Wade Barrett, Damien Sandow. I believe this was either 10 years too late, this gimmick right there, or 10 years too early, because I've watched him rise from when he first started in pro wrestling to what he could do. And I thought that the work he was doing with The Miz towards the end of his run, one, was entertaining, two, was brilliant, and he could go with anyone. The guy can work with anyone.
And got it. What's Paul saying? He got himself over, didn't he?
Got it. With so many obstacles in front of it, he got himself over, and that should have been enough for people to keep the interest behind the scenes to keep him going. But for whatever reason, it's another one of those things where they didn't see it. They didn't capitalize on him, but he was one of those. Arn Anderson, you say all the time, you don't want to be known as a hell of a hand. But Damien Sandow was in that group of a hell of a hand. They know he could put him out there with anybody, It's going to be a good match. But I thought his character development was way off the charts.
Yeah.
I thought everything he did was going great. And like I said, the stuff he was doing with The Miz, and then when he's mocking The Miz and imitating The Miz and doing all that stuff, he showed the entertaining side to him and all that. So I think it's just another missed opportunity. There was a time period when they had these young cats that could really go and could be the stars of today. So a big fan. And watched him. I watched him repackage himself, always thinking about, you know, what could get him further.
Still doing good stuff. NWA. Yeah. Aron Stevens. I like talking with Aron Stevens. He will be on this. He will be on this podcast soon.
Yeah,
in the next couple months. I've already got that locked down. I just need to get the date penciled in. But
good.
He's man, good. I imagine him a couple years later on the NXT boom. But, man, there was no reason he couldn't. Again, another person that did quite a bit.
Yeah.
But there's no reason he couldn't have done more.
Yeah.
It wasn't anything he did or didn't do. And I will say that.
They dropped the ball on him.
There's a reason he does acting and stuff like that as well. He's a whole next level on that talent.
Agreed.
Do you know what Bobby Lashley is hearing right now? Because it's actually something that everybody, including Bobby Lashley, will be hearing from now on.
Anderson. I personally, another guy that I chat with, I like him. Your interactions with him, your thoughts on him, that was asked by one of the listeners.
Yeah, Ken was another one of those guys that I never worked with, but I worked around and got to see him, and I don't know the ins and outs of what didn't make him more successful. I thought he started out, he was on fire, and he just fell from grace, whether that was internally in the back or outside of the ring or whatever. I don't know any of that stuff, and I claim complete ignorance on it. All I know is he was built like a brick. You know what I mean? He was put together good. He was athletic. He had the I mean, to me, he's LA Knight. Ken Anderson is the original LA Knight. Yeah. See the body movements and things like that, and you know that kind of stuff. So I was a big fan, and off of what we were talking about the last episode, I'm glad he's doing well and sharing that knowledge and getting other people ready for an opportunity. But it's to me, so far we're talking about three men that I think were just dropped by the wayside when they had tremendous, tremendous potential to be more than what they already were. Because he had a good run. It was a short-lived run, but it was a good run.
Massive Ken Anderson fan, but I was a huge Mr. Kennedy fan then.
Kennedy!
Yeah, I absolutely I loved Ken Anderson. I loved Mr. Kennedy, that character. But the thing about it is, I think, like you said, he just got it. I think there were some tough breaks. They kind of misdiagnosed an injury, pulled the briefcase off of him. They wanted to get the title off a take. A lot of things went into play that kind of got him there. That particular thing had nothing to do with. I think they thought he was hurt worse than he was, and then Taker being in that situation too. But, man, But just, then he was able to come back, bounce back from it, and do some more good stuff. Then I think, as always, a lot of these guys talked about it before, were able to go to TNA and just do great stuff. Kurt Angle, Bully Ray, Ken Anderson. Several people were able to go over there and do good stuff with the people they had over there. Austin Aries, AJ Styles, Christopher Daniels. They went right in the mix with those guys, and they did great stuff. So Ken Anderson is awesome. And to cap it all off, I'll say, because I watched, like we just said on the last episode, I think he's streaming right now as we're recording. To see the passion that he has about this business as he live streams and he's doing his training at the academy just says it all. And how much the business means to him.
Yeah, because you see a lot of guys, and, you know, for the lack of sounding like it's disrespectful, there's a lot of guys who get, you know, get a building, a warehouse, a ring, so, you know, some stuff, and they put a school together. But it's good to see him not, if he is, he doesn't show it. He's not bitter. And he wants to share the knowledge he has and the stuff that he's learned. And he still has a passion for the business. And that's when we really could sit here and go, well, damn, I wish it would have turned out different. But I'm happy it turned out the way it did, you know, because you can't go back and, you know, woulda, coulda, shoulda things. I see it along. And to me, that speaks a lot more about him as a person and, you know, his character as a person than anything. So good on him. And I'm glad he's doing good. And people can learn from him because he's been in that position.
Let's go to the next random thing. What is it going to be?
Oh, boy. Let's go, Val. You're up.
Hello, ladies. Pardon my appearance, but I was just doing a little casting for my next film entitled Lust in Space. Yeah, the TV show was good, but I have a rocket in my pocket that will take each and every one of you women on the face of this planet to new and exciting heights. Let's just call it Venus Envy. But I'm not a braggart. My actions speak louder than my words. And ladies, when I explode inside the World Wrestling Federation,
I never fly anymore. Bill's whispering. What a character, though, man. Do you remember this when it came out?
It was like,
again, you're on the other side.
What the heck are they doing? That was the thing. Like, are you watching this? And it was one of those had to see how far they were going to take it and how far the language was going to go and everything else. And
he ran with it. He ran with it, though, man.
They pushed the envelope with this. And that time they pushed the envelope with a lot of things. But hello, lady. Yeah, listen, there's things that stand out about that era, and Val's one of them.
What was the name of the movie he said he was going to be in?
Lust in Space.
That was it. He had so many different movie titles.
Lust.
I think what the other one was, Saving Ryan's Private. Dude, there were so many. What a time, dude. But he ran with it. I'll give him credit for that, man. He did not shy away. He embraced it.
He embraced it, yeah.
See what's next.
Spend my days working hard on the go.
tell us who is singing that.
The D-O-double-G, Road Dog, Brian James.
That's the best part. They eventually use it in a storyline, but that wasn't the original thought.
This is the first thing that comes to my mind is like when these characters and they were doing these things, they really went all out. We were quicker to just do things, and I think WWF spent a lot more time production wise. But I was one of those guys that when I actually learned that wasn't Jeff singing, I was mad. I was bamboozled.
Let's talk about this family. What was the feeling around within the industry with him and his family and everything?
With Jeff and his dad, Jerry? Jerry was the first one to give me a look in WWF. Jerry was the one who brought me up there when I was a green kid and saw something in me and gave me an opportunity. So I've been around the Jarretts for a long time. What they've meant to wrestling is silly. And this is one of those things where, like, I hope when people listen to us and watch us and get involved, we turn them on to things that they can go back and watch. And I would say to everyone, go back and watch Jeff Jarrett's career from early on in Memphis and things like that. And even go to YouTube and watch his dad and the stuff that they did. But this character was really great. And this was another character that came on strong.
Yeah.
I mean, they brought the fact of doing these vignettes for so many weeks before we ever saw them get in a ring or get physical or have a storyline that you knew them. You know what I mean? So when they debuted, it was like the best thing since sliced bread.
Your thoughts on the song itself?
I thought it was, listen, you saw me sitting there. It's the corniest thing in the world, but it's recognizable and it's a feel good thing. And you can't help but like just go, it's a honky tonk song. So
it literally seems like a song that would have been on the radio then. That's the thing about
it. Back then it would have been on the radio.
And the women singing the background vocals would get me every time.
It's like Rodney Dangerfield in Back to School when he was singing Shake It Up Baby.
All right, now we have Juventud Guerrera.
What World Championship Wrestling is all about. Great international stars from all over the world. This one from south of the border. He is from Mexico. Welcome, amigo, to Worldwide. And Juventud Guerrera, a lot of things happening. You're one of the more exciting stars in that super cruiserweight division. But what kind of influence is Eddie Guerrero having on you right now?
You know, all this time it's been happening so many things in my life, in my career. And now with Eddie Guerrero, I feel so happy to be with him, you know, share a room with him, share a ring with him, because I got a lot of respect for him. Because when I was a boy, I started in Mexico, so I used to saw him like my idol, you know, like the superstar. So now I come here to the United States and I have the opportunity to be with the man, because he's, for me, he's the best wrestler of the world.
But some get the impression that Eddie Guerrero is very pushy, especially of the great Mexican talent that we have here.
You know, I know Eddie is going to take the right way. I know Eddie.
For a fact, you know that, Juventud?
I can say that.
It's got to come from in here, then.
Yeah, I could feel it. I could feel it from here, from my, it's coming from my heart, because I know Eddie. And so I trust Eddie. I don't know what's going to happen, but Eddie wants to do, I'm going to follow him.
Very quickly, in your native tongue, Spanish, a beautiful language. Go right ahead.
Bueno, soy con Eddie porque él es mi ídolo, es mi maestro, es mi teacher, y voy a estar con él siempre.
Muchas gracias. I thank you very much. Juventud Guerrera, right here on Worldwide.
The juice has come back. When he started imitating The Rock, on our programming, it was hysterical because he was dead serious. But to the rest of us, it was a laughing stock. But he was dead serious that the juice, baby, the juice is in the house.
We would have had him do commentary for a few weeks.
He was a laugh riot. and then he kind of fell from grace there in Australia.
What about his talent?
A lot of talent. All those guys that came in, and Conan never get the credit for bringing in the talent that he brought in, or at least nurtured coming in. But Hoovy was he was amazing. He was right up there with Ray and the rest of those cats. So I was a big fan, and he was a lot of fun. He's a fun guy.
Found himself in the wrong spot more often than not.
Yeah, he quite often walked on the wrong side of the tracks. Yeah,
so talented. It's crazy.
But yeah, does it? He was one of those. I think he learned, unfortunately, the hard way, as some do, that talent doesn't protect you from the rest of the world.
Yet
it doesn't excuse you from things. So.
So we've got, we'll segue.
All right.
Hello, my name is Eugene. Do you want a chocolate? I could eat about 1.5 million of these. My mama always said, life is like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're gonna get. But I think life is more like WrestleMania. Like in WrestleMania 3 when Hogan picked up Andre the Giant and he body slammed him. Or last year WrestleMania when Chris Benoit, he made Triple H tap out. Or WrestleMania 14, when Mike Tyson punched Shawn Michaels in the face, he just ran back and boom! Oh no. Uh-oh.
So this Nick Dinsmore could possibly be the number one wrestler with a black cloud over his head. And the black cloud, I mean, like, This guy can go.
Yeah.
He can go. So much so that he was a teacher at OVW. People went to him. He was a student of the game. He could go with anyone, and nothing he did grabbed anybody's attention. The most serious guy about the business, and he could work. His work was solid. His body was good. Young, strong, the whole kit and caboodle. And they just didn't see, every time he came up for a dark match, they just didn't see anything in him. Everybody liked him. And all of a sudden, this character comes along. You took all of his wrestling and put it in the corner. And he became one of the most entertaining and loved characters in the history of the WWF. And so it's the transformation. And that's what happened to a lot of those guys. The Damien Sandow guys, you know, the guys that were coming from that time, these guys could go, but they wound up being more entertaining than the craft that they worked so hard at. And Nick's mind is really good.
But how do you get a character like that?
But you can't, you know, you could never replace that again. Now you can't come across that way. And they took a lot of heat for.
We talked about Ramada San last week. Last time I recorded, yeah. That's another one. Eugene's another one. What are you going to do after that?
That's it. Once Eugene doesn't get fixed, it's what's that Jack Nicholson, One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. That's it. The only thing you can do then is zap him and take his brain out. But Nick was another guy who I feel was underappreciated and underutilized. This gimmick worked good, but it was, could only go to a certain point. And, you know, when they were done with it, they were done with it. You can
sure get heat bullying Eugene Kramer.
But great, great character. And he's another one of those young cats in that time frame that had it all. And just whatever they were looking for, you had to be willing to fill those shoes. And he did.
Yeah. Another thing that you could not quite do today.
No, you definitely can't get away with any of that stuff.
A three-way for the TNA heavyweight title at Sacrifice between you, Kurt Angle, and Samoa Joe. Now, before you get there, you have an important step tonight as you and X-Division champion Petey Williams take on the unlikely duo of Kurt Angle and Samoa Joe.
You know, they say all men are created equal, but you look at me and you look at Small Joe and you can see that statement is not true. See, normally if you go one-on-one with another wrestler, you got a 50-50 chance of winning. But I'm a genetic freak and I'm not normal. So you got a 25% at best at beating me. And then you add Kurt Angle to the mix, your chances of winning drastically go down. See, the three-way at Sacrifice, you got a 33 1/3 chance of winning. But I got a 66 2/3 chance of winning because Kurt Angle knows he can't beat me and he's not even going to try. So Samoa Joe, you take your 33 1/3 chance minus my 25% chance and you got an 8 1/3 chance of winning at Sacrifice. But then you take my 75% chance of winning if we used to go one-on-one and then add 66 2/3%. I got 141 2/3 chance of winning at Sacrifice. See, Joe, the numbers don't lie, and they spell disaster for you.
That was that the beginning, or was that in the middle of everybody learning Steiner math?
Yeah, I think this is what launched it into utter space.
Yeah, because every time he did it, it was entertaining as crap, and always so serious. Always
got one. It's got one volume, one voice.
Oh God!
Big Papa Pump, man.
But it goes back to your point, and you bring this up a lot. A lot of guys did some of their best work when they went to TNA.
Yeah, you definitely wouldn't have thought he'd go in and have another run, but he did.
Yeah.
Main event picture. Came in to WWF. They did some main event stuff with Triple H with him. I don't think they were ever too. I can't speak for that. Didn't seem like they ever.
They weren't high on it. They weren't high on it.
He didn't stop there, though. He went on TNA and did more stuff. Your experience with Scott Steiner?
Love him. Love him. A lot of people have different, you know, everybody has an opinion of everybody. They have an opinion of me and everything else. From the minute I met them, both him and Rick were always good to me as far as when I was a young kid walking into WCW. When I worked with them, walked and talked to me, were very beyond cordial in the back, you know, spent time in Japan with them as well. And I got a lot of opportunities to work with both Scott and Rick in singles and then in tag stuff. And I enjoyed it. And I learned a lot from them. And they were always professional and always cool with me. And I think that's the thing. Like, if you're cool with people and they're cool with you, the rest is easy. But Scott was the one who started giving me my breakout opportunity with that U.S. title at the pay-per-view when I worked with him. So I have a lot of good memories of working with Scott and Rick and big fans of theirs.
Exactly 3 weeks ago, Eric Bischoff tried to fire each and every one of you. He called you worthless. He called you imbeciles. He said things to you that would shock the old and the elderly. Well, if it's a war he wants, it's a war he's gonna get. Now show me your war faces. Right. Corporal Cajun, you have a handle.
I'm the Corporal Cajun. Look at what I'm saying. I got one mission, and that's to let that little ball down. Rolling.
Hammer.
Sir.
You will now be known as Major Stash.
Cool, sir.
Chavo Guerrero Jr.
Yes, sir.
You will now be known as Lieutenant Loco. Any one of you punks touch me or my stuff, and I will kill you.
Hey, not me, man. I like plenty of stuff. I'll share.
Misfits, we have a new cadet. And believe me, they're the biggest set of bombs I've ever seen. Major Guns, fall into line. Misfits, let's go to war. Misfits, let's go to war.
Favorite faction you're a part of and why?
Favorite faction I was part of is the Misfits.
I knew you'd say that.
And don't get me wrong, like the Dungeon of Doom, I was surrounded by legends.
Yeah.
And
in the Alliance, you were having the time of your life.
The Alliance, no, took the wind out of my sails.
I know.
But the first family, I was with Jimmy Hart, my whole WCW, you know, so I was in a bunch of different factions, But the Misfits is when we got to be ourselves, and they started to give us a little bit of creative freedom and had a little bit of input on what we were doing, and then allowed us to be who we were and work the way we wanted.
We talked about this before. This was a cool point for you guys because a lot of people had checked out, and then you guys were able to kind of do step up and do some work. You, Lance Torrance, there's so many people.
Yeah. I mean, they literally, it was a backstage thing. They literally called us a bunch of Misfits. They don't know what to do with us. And so we became the Misfits in action. And, you know, you took a bunch of guys they had no idea what to do with and didn't really care about, and we turned it into something pretty cool.
Plus, you had a cool name.
Yeah, I did. My merchandise sales were out of this world. I couldn't even sign an autograph for that name.
Such a cool time, dude. A lot of people were so like over WCW, but for me, it was a cool time for a select few people, I guess is what I'm trying to say.
It really was. It, you know, because you hear a lot of guys who talk about it and
like what Lance Storm, dude. You gotta see Lance Storm get the ball and run with it.
God,
that's awesome.
It was so smooth. So smooth and so there on everything and so willing to give and take. And there's not enough words or adjectives I could use to describe Lance Storm as a person or a professional. But it really was. It was hard to realize, like, the ship was sinking, but man, were we partying. And by party, I mean, were we enjoying ourselves and really having a good time in what we were getting the opportunity to do. So our schedule got harder and everything because we were on the road longer because we were a couple of those guys who never complained about anything. So they just kept putting us on everything.
Yeah. Really? We got one more thing on the evening here, Bill.
Okay.
There's a secret to how it works. First, Private Payne isn't lifting Ben Hurt by himself. They're actually working together to pull off this trick. It's really Ben who's pushing off of Private Payne's thighs to launch himself into the air. See? There's the push-off. But that's not the only secret. Private Payne isn't trying to hurt his opponent. He's actually trying to help him by not slamming him down until his head is safely tucked in. He avoids injury by landing flat on his back, not on his head. Now for basic rule number two, the punch.
If a 280-pound guy punched a 300-pound guy in the face, he'd either have no teeth or a broken jaw.
He's right. No one could take a beating like this if the punches were real. So what's the secret?
Almost all the wrestlers in the ring tend to work light. We touch very light. All the holes are very light. Because we might make it look as believable as possible with as little injury to each other as possible.
Just like in a back alley brawl, a closed fist can cause serious damage when it lands on someone's chin. So how do the wrestlers avoid getting hurt? Here's the secret. An open fist, which doesn't pack any real punch. Unlike movie stuntmen, wrestlers don't swing and miss. They make light contact so their opponent will know when to react. From this angle, we can see that the punches are so light, they barely touch the wrestler's stomach. The fans think they're real because they don't know the secrets.
Do you remember when this came out? Exposed. Yeah. Pro wrestling's greatest secrets.
This is just, it's like, I started to sweat. My blood's starting to boil.
The All Elite cronies sent this in and they said, was Bill Private Payne?
The answer is no. And then hell no.
What was the... Okay, so first of all, this came out about 10 years too late. They really wanted to make a splash, I guess. They should have probably worked on it before it was all over national TV everywhere. But man, do you remember when this came out? What were people thinking?
The biggest thing that was finding out who they were.
Which I'm sure everybody did.
I think as time went on, everybody found out who they were. But it was more like, you gotta be kidding me.
A lot of them said it was pitched differently, though. I'm trying to remember what the exact story was, but yeah.
If I remember correctly, so I'm not saying I remember 100% correctly, but it was one of those things of, let's get those guys in here. Because it's clear that they had some kind of knowledge of something, but they were coming off as these guys were the end all be all. But I remember that stuff, and it was infuriating at the time. One, it was insulting, but it was infuriating. And then sitting here watching it now, half of it's funny, but the other half, like I said, I started to sweat. I started to get a little angry going, it brought back that, really? Really? Is that where we're at with this?
The quote, if you know the secret.
If you know the secret. The third most lead, the stop.
It goes to Suplex. It's about a 45-minute documentary, well, a TV special.
My coach would have done everything to make sure you could never lift your feet off the mat again if you stomped. There was no such, and that's the thing, is like all these myths and it just put me in a bad mood.
I think the stomp, and I always heard somebody was saying something the other day on one of the On This Day of Pro Wrestling History clips. I think it was Bret Hart in WCW. It was that WCW ring that made it worse.
Oh.
It wasn't like WWF ring.
Oh, no.
Stomp all day and it wouldn't sound like that.
Not at all. That ring was horrendous. And it was a 18-foot, where WWE's 20-foot. So we were all lightning fast in WCW, but those rings hurt like hell. And it was cable. And it was, oh, for the love of Pete. But you got so used to it, you didn't know any better.
Yeah.
You know?
The stomping definitely sounded more amplified on the old rings.
Yes. Stomp, brother. Make the sound.
Hogan never stomped.
Well, that was one of my biggest pet peeves. So when I started training people and they come in and they had a preconceived notion of what it was, that every time they did something like that, it was a payday. We were doing something different. You stomp, you pay.
You stomp, you pay. If you know the secrets.
If you know the secrets.
Yeah, I think the voice actor is the best part of that, though.
Oh, God.
Anyway,
different guys every time, right? They had different characters.
Well, I'm talking the voice act, the guy voicing over narrative. Right. They had different characters. Yeah, they had several different characters.
Yeah.
There's all sorts of online speculation about who each character was. But yeah, I talk about the voice actor narrating it.
If you know the secret.
It's like he was telling you something like you'd been robbed and he was explaining to you why. Not that you'd been entertained or anything, just that you've been robbed and I'm going to tell you why.
Maddening.
Yep, I remember that when it came out. Dude, we just recorded some extra content so we could take the week of Christmas off. This will come out the week after that, but still, nevertheless, it was a fun 10 little, I don't know what to call them, promo packages I put together.
I like them, yeah.
For everybody put together.
That was good. And again, I hope people, when they watch this episode and when they watch what we're doing, when we're showing those kind of packages, when you put those together and we get those individuals, I hope they go and look them up and see their body of work.
Yeah.
And the things that they've done, because everybody that we've talked about up until that last snippet was, you know, did so much in the business and so much for the business that it's really a good educational tool for the up and comers and people that are trying to reinvent themselves. Those are some guys that I would suggest they watch.
If you know the secret.
If you know the
man, I'm going to have to watch that whole thing now. It's been a long time. God. It'd be brutal. But yeah, they just think that you're this, everybody watching is just a complete idiot.
Yeah. Yeah.
They really thought they were hitting each other. They do talk about the chairs. I remember the chairs. There's nothing, basically there's nothing fake about the chair. It's how you hit them with the chair.
Well, I wish there was people I knew who watched that segment then, because some of them.
I always saw that El Generico Sammy's thing. Oh, he hit Kevin Owens with that chair earlier.
Yeah, I would have stood right up and beat him.
It's a home run, wasn't it?
Oh, my gosh.
Anyway. Bill, man, thanks for staying over with us. And those listening, everybody, thank you for listening live. It's been fun, man. Now we can spend some time with our families.
Yeah.
But again, thank you for the awesome year getting to know you. And get to spend time with you every week. This is fun.
And thank you, brother. And thank to everybody who's sending the questions. And, you know, we're on all the social media platforms now. I look forward to meeting and getting to know a lot more of our followers and listeners. But what a great year. And I hope everybody enjoyed this episode. And just thank you, man. Thank you for what you do on all your all your podcasts and the guys that you got coming up. And I'm just looking forward to a good 2024, man.
Same here, man. I'm just all in all in life and on the podcast.
Yes. So yes.
Podcast is growing. We appreciate all your support. Yeah. Go to BillDeMott.com. You have links to everything there. Video form, audio form. Obviously it's available wherever you watch or listen to your, or consume your podcast. So yeah, again, thanks everybody to all the support lately. We really, really like watching it. Look at that. We got Noah sending us on our farewells here.
Love it.
Yeah, beat that. I like how it's Bill and Lacey are.
That's our Facebook page. That's our.
Okay, so what he's saying is that's the name of your fit. He did that, like the at it. Okay.
Nice.
Okay. Well, Noah and everybody else listening live, we appreciate it. And until next time, let's say yours. Say yours first. I like yours. Say yours, then I'll do mine.
Do what you say. Say what you mean. Mean what you do.
And keep being you and keep being great.
Jeff Townsend Media. CG, good night.
And the question is, do I stay here?
Will you be back? Are you going to come back? Will you be back? Are you coming back?